Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Alex Petrescu and I welcome you today to my finance and accounting education channel here on YouTube once again. As promised in the latest video, I said that I will come back in a few days with a commentary, because the last presentation was about the latest course that I released and there was no commentary on a topic of general interest, just as we have already gotten used to on my channel. And today I want to talk to you about semiconductors, so chips, the little electronic components that are part of most of the appliances, cars and so on and so forth nowadays in our world. And we are going to do a short sector analysis. Mainly, you might ask yourself, why semiconductors, what is so special about them? Mainly because I see them as a very important or very interesting investment opportunity for the next period. And the first thing, just to jump right in, I want to talk about when I'm thinking about the semiconductors, so this little electronic devices that are part of our everyday life now, I'm thinking about the shortage. If you haven't been living under a rock for the last one and a half years, you might have already heard in the news. You just have here on this slide some titles from press all over the world, from United States, international news agencies, from United Kingdom, France, Germany, Austria, it doesn't really matter. It was present in all the newspapers and on television and everywhere, that there is a shortage crisis. Of course, the reasons are multiple. Let's just say that the pandemic is one of them, and the increase of demand for electronic devices, and because everybody was staying at home and everybody was buying webcams and new computers and better screens and potentially also TV sets and all sorts of electronic devices with which they could communicate with colleagues at work or with the family and so on and so forth. That was, let's say, one of the troubles. Then of course there is the trouble that the supply chains faced also because of the pandemic, and the difficulties, also the ship that got stuck, the large cargo ship that got stuck in the Panama Canal is quoted as a problem, and what came after that till the Panama Canal was really once again free for traffic. And another one which it's quoted, and I think it might also play a role, is the of course the, let's say, the economic conflict between the United States and China. United States has tried to let's say to block access of mostly of Huawei, but also of other companies to processors, to semiconductors. And hence there were some major problems related to that. Long story short, a lot of car manufacturers, including Tesla, I think even here in the news you have it's like the first one on the left side on top, but not only Tesla, all the car manufacturers are complaining. Other industries, somehow the producers have tried to prioritize the manufacturing of processors which are more expensive. It's only normal that the ones that are bringing them the biggest gains have to take priority, and there is this shortage. But this shortage shows only that the perspectives for the industry, for the sector, are fantastic. But it's not only that. If we think what's happening in the world right now, and if we are thinking in terms of Industry 4.0 and Internet of Things, and everybody should be aware that there will be electronics and electronic devices and these semiconductors and chips in many things in the years to come. In refrigerators, in wash machines, and they will communicate, and they will be connected through the 5G networks and so on and so forth. And the demand for such components will be increasing exponentially, and it's clear right now. We have, let's say, that this crisis is now a short-term factor, but if you are thinking into the long term, there will be a strong demand for these products in the future as well. The story with the, because you might ask yourself, one year, 1.5 years, why are they building more factories? The story is very simple. The factories which are producing these semiconductors are very difficult to build. They need to be very well sealed. There needs to be no dust inside. They are also very expensive. I understood that at least 1 billion is the price for one factory, but it can go up to 3 billions. They need sources of very clean water and all sorts of conditions. And basically, if it would be something else, you have no understanding why they are not building more facilities. However, most of the manufacturers of the big players have announced already that they are going to invest a lot in the production capacities. And I think right now what has happened, it was a clear signal for them that they need to invest a lot. And that's why I'm saying this is a very good potential for a long-term investment, in my opinion. And because I'm trying to, let's say, I'm not going to recommend you one specific company which is in this field. I'll have the approach of Vanguard or what is it called, State Street or Black Guard, or these investment funds which are like the index investment funds that are buying everything that is in the market. And if one of the manufacturers is failing, there is absolutely no problem, the other one will succeed. However, because of what I just said, of the shortage of the future, what the importance of the electronics in our lives in the future. I mean, if you are only thinking about the Neuralink from Elon Musk as a proposal, and the let's say that the potential for the industry is quite high, in my opinion. Now let's go to the players. Of course, we start with the Intel from the United States. Used to be a very good and very important player in the sector. It still is. However, it has lost the leadership in the market. If you are looking on the left side, you have the share price evolution in the last 5 years. It's not spectacular, let's say, probably because they have lost this leadership. The share price varied between 48 and maximum 68, and there is clearly no growth trend here. However, because they are exclusively a semiconductor manufacturer, their profit margin, which is on the right side of the screen on the top, it's quite high, almost 28%. If you are looking in 2020, it's a profitable company. If you are looking at the bottom, at the earnings per share, also increasing and steady for the past 4 years. It's a good company. We will come back later talking about it. However, it's not probably the most attractive, mainly because it's no longer the leader of the segment of the sector. Then another major player is Samsung. Unlike Intel, Samsung has the quality that it's not only involved in the semiconductors manufacturing. They are producing a lot of other electronic appliances. You might already know, computers, mobile phones, and so on and so forth. So tablets. They are not specialized like Intel, as their profit margin is not that high as percent. However, I think it's from the four companies that I'm presenting to you today is the biggest one, with revenues of 236 trillions. So it's the biggest one from the fourth. Also, the earnings per share are not that impressive, meaning that they suffered a drop in 2019 with a slight recovery in 2020. Also, because I have previously spoken in a presentation of mine, actually in a course, about this price here, it so happens that it's in dollar and it's actually for, I think, for 25 shares. So it's not a price per share. Then the third one, and which is actually the let's say, if we take out the fact that Samsung is also manufacturing something else, not only semiconductors, the TSMC would be, so Samsung is from South Korea, TSMC is from Taiwan, actually that's exactly the name of the company, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company Limited. I wouldn't be surprised if you have never heard about it. It's one of the biggest surprises. People didn't hear about it, and it's such a big player in this area. Probably haven't heard about it because it's not a your typical business to customer brand, so you don't see them in the advertising and so on and so forth. If we are talking about Samsung, we didn't say about the shares. Entering at the beginning of 2020 and buying shares could have been a good idea. If you look at this 5 years horizon, let's say that you could have gained maybe a 70% increase of your shares if you would have bought the Samsung shares in 2020. It's the same with TSMC. At the beginning of 2020, of course, it was an opportunity. I chose another five companies which have also an average growth now at more than 90%. So I had limited resources, but those two, so Samsung and TSMC, would have also been good alternatives. So entering, opening a long-term position on TSMC at the beginning of 2020 could have potentially brought you also a 100% increase, so from around 50 to 115. How much is it now? So even more than 100% increase. Being also semiconductors, purely semiconductors manufacturer, has also an impressive profit margin. So namely 37%. Which is far higher than the one of Samsung. So they are very, it seems like these semiconductors are very profitable. And also their earning per share exploded in 2020. It's clear that, so basically none of these companies have losses or problems with the cash flow or with the balance sheet or any troubles. It's just a matter of personal taste. Intel, let's say it's like the old lady in the room. What would you call, according to Boston Consulting, so BCG Matrix, cash cow already. The other ones proved to have potential to grow. And bonus, you get from me a company which is not really in the semiconductor industry, but it's the supplier for all the others. And that's why I think that this is the most interesting of them all, because this one is manufacturing some the machines which are used to craft the semiconductors. The technology is called lithography, if I'm not mistaken. They are producing some unique equipments which are costing 150 million a piece. They could not be replicated by our friends from China so far, and probably they will never be replicated. It's ASML is a European company, it's in the Netherlands. One of the major founders and shareholders is Philips. And let's say that without these guys, all the others won't be performing that good as they are. Also, buying at the beginning of 2020, so would have brought you a little bit more than 100% increase. So you see, like, they are at 788 and you had prices under 400 at the beginning of 2020, so a clear and steady growth trend. They have also quite a substantial profit margin, more than 20, so almost 25%, and also their earnings per share are steadily increasing in the past 4 years, so it's also a good player. And it's a good player mainly because the others are depending on them. Now, what's also interesting about these four companies is that if you take this BlackRock Vanguard State Street approach and you are buying and you decide to open long-term positions on all of them, you are also somehow covering the geographical diversification principle, meaning that you have Intel in the United States mainly, so we're a United States company. You have ASML is in Europe, the one which is producing the printing machines, so the lithography machines. TSMC is in Taiwan. Here I have some doubts because of the relation of that country with China, and from political point of view, and it's a little bit riskier investment. And Samsung, of course, which is from South Korea. So you have Asia, you have Europe, and you have United States. So it's a very good geographical spread. And there are some other considerations. I'm saying that Intel is using the 0.7 nanometers, I think they are called. So it's a measuring unit for dimension. And okay, the smaller they get, the better they are. TSMC and Samsung are using 0.5 nanometers right now and announced to be going to 0.3 in a few years. IBM has a 0.2 prototype that they announced. They already have an 0.2 prototype, which is supposedly going to consume 4 times less energy. The idea is that the smaller the better, because it's consuming less energy, and of course in a given volume you can incorporate more computing power. That's absolutely clear. Then there are some major players, but which are sourcing the semiconductors. Actually, they are building stuff with them. Besides the ones which are related to auto industry, which are making the components for cars, you have the AMD and Nvidia, mostly known for their graphic cards, but also Qualcomm, the major players which don't own factories and they cannot be considered actually in the semiconductors sector, are also called fabless. What is surprising is that Intel looks like they are somehow throwing the towel, because besides sourcing a part of their processors from TSMC, in January 2021 they have also initiated discussions with Samsung, so basically to buy products from Samsung. But in the same time, they say they have a strategy to reclaim the top manufacturer position by 2025. So it's let's say that out of these four companies, if you're asking me in which one to invest, Intel is the one I need to think the most about, because they are surprising, and given the history and their current position and what they want to do and what they have done in the past, I don't know in which direction they will go. And another factor to be considered is, of course, the dividend yield. In the end, because we have talked about earning per share, but we know that that's not so relevant because the shares don't have the same price. And the equity of a company, so the number of shares which are in the market, is also different for each company. So there are big differences, but the dividend yield is the highest for Samsung, 3.65%. given the fact that they also have some other, let's say, line of products, Intel is with 2.6%, TSMC with 1.22%, and ASML with 0.4%. This is also showing that the ones with the lowest dividend yield are also the heaviest investors, that they are having the retained profits at the highest possible level because they are reinvesting it. So that would be it about this sector. I do think that's a very good opportunity to invest, and just as I have said, think about it. If you if it's in your intention to invest in the let's say in the next period, do think about this sector. I mean, it's out there, it's clear there is a need for the products of these companies. There is a shortage right now, so it has a lot of potential. Please don't forget to like my video if you like it, to share it with somebody if you think they would be interested, to comment if you have anything to add to the discussion. And most important, don't forget to hit the like button for my video, and to hit to subscribe to my channel. And also, there are, you can support me not only by doing all these things, but also there is at the bottom of this video there is a link to eToro. You can create, because we are talking about investment, you can create an account on eToro and trade there without commission and fees. There are some opportunities from Amazon, basically to Audible, to free Audibles if you like audiobooks, or joining the Kindle program if you like reading electronic books. I have a Kindle myself. And last but not least, a wish list with electronic products and software which can help me improve my the quality of my videos. Once again, this was the today's presentation. We talked about semiconductors and the biggest player in the sector. My name is Alex Petrescu. I thank you for your attention, and I look forward to presenting to you next time. Goodbye.